Amen. So before we read the text, I titled sections of this passage today. The main title overall is this: God's grace doesn't stop at justification. Now, before we read the text, I want to talk about what justification is. We've been hearing the phrase, the term, a lot. So let's get a really good definition of justification before we move forward. And it's on your sheet, question 33 from the Shorter Catechism. What is justification? Justification is an act of God's free grace, wherein he pardoneth all our sins and accepteth us as righteous in his sight, only for the righteousness of Christ imputed to us and received by faith alone. So justification is where, to summarize, make it very, very simple, is where God forgives us, he clothes us in the righteousness of Christ, and this can only be received by faith alone. Does that make sense? Justification.
Yeah, all right. Talk about imputation for a second.
I summarize that by saying where that's when Christ clothes us in his righteousness. You want to expand on that?
Well, I mean, I guess, you know, kind of using $50 words here. So, you know, and obviously we're reading from the Westminster Confession. I just want to make it understood that when it says Christ imputed that righteousness to us, it's that we understand that justification is not anything that is in us, but the finished work of Christ.
Yes.
Right? So.
Yes. Yes, because we couldn't have righteousness of our own, we needed righteousness that wasn't our own. And where do we get that righteousness? We get it from Jesus Christ, where not only was our sins put onto him on the cross, but his righteousness is put on us so that we can be right in God's sight. All right? Now, by way of introduction, let me just paint kind of the context for you, because as you can see in verse 1, Paul says, what shall we say then? Well, we kind of got to do a quick review. Well, Paul has laid out some basics to the Christian faith. We are all dead in our sins, but through faith in Christ, we can have peace with God. So, God's grace abounds and covers all of our sins like a massive tsunami. Okay, we are in sin, but God's grace just crashes over us while we are still in our sin. Okay? Keep that in your mind. In the midst of our sin, God's grace abounds. Okay, keep that in your mind.
Let's go. Illustration of tsunami.
Cool. So let's read the passage that we have this morning, 1-14, Romans 6. What shall we say then? Are we to continue in sin that grace may abound? By no means. How can we who died to sin still live in it? Do you not know that all of us who have been baptized into Christ Jesus were baptized into his death? We were buried, therefore, with him by baptism into death, in order that, just as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, we too might walk in newness of life. For if we have been united with him in a death like his, we shall certainly be united with him in a resurrection like his. Excuse me. We know that our old self was crucified with him in order that the body of sin might be brought to nothing, so that we would no longer be enslaved to sin. For one who has died has been set free from sin. Now if we have died with Christ, we believe that we will also live with him. We know that Christ, being raised from the dead, will never die again. Death no longer has dominion over him. For the death he died to sin once for all. But the life he lives to God. So you also must consider yourselves dead to sin and alive to God in Christ Jesus. Let not sin, therefore, reign in your mortal body to make you obey its passions. Do not present your members to sin as instruments for unrighteousness, but present yourselves to God as those who have been brought from death to life, and your members to God as instruments for righteousness. For sin will have no dominion over you, since you are not under law, but under grace. Alrighty, so we're just going to go through this couple of verses at a time. What shall we say then? God's grace abounds in the midst of our sin. So, it might be a valid question to ask, okay, if we are sinning, and God's grace abounds in the midst of that sin, should we just continue to sin? So God's grace would still abound, right? What's Paul's answer?
God forbid,
by no means. And why is this? Well, because God's grace doesn't stop at justification. Because God's grace doesn't stop at justification. Look at your sheet again. There's a section 2 that's from chapter 11 of the Westminster Confession. That's going to help me explain this point here. Faith, thus receiving and resting on Christ and his righteousness, is the alone instrument of justification. Yet it is not alone in the person justified, but is ever accompanied with all other saving graces, and is no dead faith, but works by love. So there's a simple summary of that, and it goes like this. We are saved by faith alone, but not...
A faith that is alone.
But not a faith that is alone. We're saved by faith alone, but that faith is never alone. It's, as it says here, ever accompanied with all other saving graces. So should we sin, continue in sin, so that grace may abound? By no means, because God's grace doesn't stop there. We not only, he's going to go on to say, we not only died with Christ, but we were raised with him. We were united to Christ. So let's go on here. Verses 3 and 4. Do you not know that all of us who have been baptized into Christ Jesus were baptized into his death? We were buried, therefore, with him by baptism into death, in order that, just as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, we too might walk in newness of life. So Paul's primary point there is that we have union with Christ, so how could we continue to sin? I'm going to get back to that, but before we get to that, I have to address something that is kind of just sticking out like a sore thumb in the text. I just have to. Is Paul speaking of actual water baptism, or is he speaking of what baptism means? Is Paul speaking of the sign, baptism, i.e., my handwriting's bad, baptism, or is he speaking of what it signifies? The answer...
Letter.
Signifies. This is what it signifies.
The answer is yes. And I'm going to try my best to explain why the answer is yes. So the Bible does say that we were baptized into Christ Jesus. Peter says in 1 Peter 3 that baptism now saves you, not by an appeal to God, not by washing off the dirt from the body, but an appeal to God for a clean conscience. Peter's asked in Acts 2, what must you do to be saved? He said, repent and be baptized for the forgiveness of your sins. How do we reconcile that truth with the plain fact of Scripture that there's people who get baptized and then die and perish and spend eternal punishment away from God? How can we reconcile those two things? Well, we reconcile it like this. And the Westminster Confession of Faith really helps. And again, if this doesn't make too much sense to you, this is recorded, and also you have elders who are willing to sit with you and explain this for hours, okay? So the reason is baptism only means something for the people of God, okay? Baptism is only a means of grace for when it is received by faith, okay? So look at Calvin's quote there, and I hope this really, really helps, and speak up if it doesn't help at all, okay? It is irrelevant to argue that this power is not apparent in all the baptized. For Paul, because he is speaking to believers, connects the reality and the effect with the outward sign in his usual manner. So Paul connects the sign and what it signifies in his usual manner. We know that whatever the Lord offers by the visible symbol is confirmed and ratified by their faith. In short, he teaches us what the truth of baptism is when rightly received. Okay, so you reconcile this people are baptized and they spend eternity away from the Lord. And the Bible says things like we were baptized, all who were baptized into Christ Jesus. Right, so how do you reconcile this? Well, Paul is always speaking and Peter is speaking of what baptism means when it is accepted rightly by faith. God's sacraments are means of his grace. Now, We do have to move on, okay? But Pastor Bob did just preach a sermon on this. That could be helpful. You could go back and listen to that. Also, Westminster Confession of Faith answers these questions in length, and also ask questions. Go to an elder, go to someone who you know has studied a little bit about this, and ask them, okay? But I had to address it because it's kind of sticking out as a sore thumb. Paul says we were baptized into Christ Jesus, okay? So again, just to summarize, baptism only means what it really means for the elect. Make sense?
And that's who he's talking
at least a little bit
in this book.
Yes, and he's speaking to the church of God, okay? So he's not going to preface every little statement that he makes, okay? All right, so back to Paul's main point. Should we sin so that grace may abound? May it never be, because we were united to Christ in his death and in his resurrection. And why do we have union with Christ? Verse 4. Why do we have union with Christ? The end of verse 4. Boom. Can you say it a little louder for the camera?
I'm sorry. We walk in a newness of life.
Yes. So that we may walk in newness of life. Amen. So of course you shouldn't sin so that grace may abound. Okay, because the whole purpose of being united to Christ is so that we can walk as Christ walked. So that we can walk in his ways and obey God. We have been freed from the power of sin. So verses 5 through 11, I have titled on your sheet as, you not only died with Christ, but you were raised with Christ. Let's focus a little bit on verses 5 and 6. Verse 5, for if we have been united with him in death like his, we shall certainly be united with him in a resurrection like his. We know that our old self was crucified with him in order that the body of sin might be brought to nothing, so that we would no longer be enslaved to sin. Now, in verse 5, Paul asserts the main header under 5 through 11, that we not only died with Christ, but we were also raised with Christ. So if you believe that you died with Christ, that your sins were put on him, Paul's kind of logic here is, well, of course you're going to be raised with Christ, right? Now, notice in verse 6, Paul says that our old self was crucified with him. Now, why was our old self crucified with him? In order that the body of sin might be brought to nothing. So there's something that we got to stop and kind of talk about here for a little bit. And it's the way Paul speaks throughout his letters. He uses past, present, and future tense to explain the same point. So, can someone explain past, present, and future tense to me?
That's which happened, that which is, and that will happen in the future.
Bingo. So, yeah, bingo. So notice that Paul says that our old self was crucified, past, in order that the old man might die. The old man was crucified in order that the old man might die. And through Paul's letters, you also hear him say things like, you were saved, you are being saved, and you will be saved.
Right. That, I think that is in Romans as well, when he talks about the first man, Adam, which was the earth, but the second Adam was the Lord from above. So he had to take us out of that sin, that disobedience that Adam brought on the whole human race. By him dying on the cross, being obedient to the death of the cross.
Yeah, sure. So, notice that in this passage, you will see Paul use that past, present, and future tense all over the place about the same subject, kind of spread all around. So, I don't want that to confuse you in any way. That's how Paul speaks. We have been united to Christ, we died with him and were raised, and yet we are waiting to be raised. And yet our old man is not completely dead yet. Okay? So this gets us into the topic of sanctification. Sanctification. What is sanctification?
Sanctification is a grace of God.
Yes. Bingo.
Keep going.
They always start with
free grace.
Yes. Right.
By which we are conformed more and more to the image of Christ.
Yes. And how is this conforming done? That's an important point that I think is Paul speaking up here. The shedding off of the old man. Okay? So it's not just that we kind of keep our sins, you know, and we kind of, sanctification is walking towards Christ. You know, I can't finish the example because then I have to take stuff off. But it's more that we're walking towards Christ and we're taking off the old man.
Yeah.
Okay?
And he helps us to do that.
Amen.
James chapter 1.
Mm.
And that's the only thing that we really participate in, that we have.
Yes, and just to speak on the doctrine of sanctification for a moment, is it all of God, or do we participate? And the answer with sanctification is yes. Another yes question. Okay. Another yes. Yes, it is all of God. It's really summarized in Philippians 2 pretty well. Work out your own salvation with fear and trembling. Work it out. For it is God who works in you, both to will and to work for his good pleasure. Yes. Alright. Yes. Alright. Verses 7 through 11. Any comments or questions so far? Before we move on, Paul is dealing with very important topic. His main topic is sanctification. It could be a little theological, you know, using a lot of speech that we don't use necessarily in our everyday lives. So is there any questions so far before I move on?
I think a key word in that portion of scripture is, that you covered is crucified.
Mm.
You know, when we talk about crucifixion, that's a very long and painful death.
Mm. That's a really good point. And that mirrors sanctification. Sanctification through the Christian life is slow, painful, lots of falling on your knees before God, repenting, wringing out your soul. The old Puritans used to call repentance the vomit of the soul.
Nice.
Yeah. Imagine your soul, your soul being kind of thrown out before God.
That's why Jesus said, if anyone would come after me, let him take up his cross,
yes,
place of crucifixion, deny himself, and follow me.
Yeah. Amen. All right, verse 7 and 8, let's kind of look to this. For one who has died has been set free from sin. Now, if we have died with Christ, we believe that we will also live with him. So 7 and 8 kind of repeats the primary point that you not only died with Christ, but you were raised with Christ. And again, that point is connected to, should we sin so that grace may abound? No, because you were raised. You didn't just die. You were united to Christ in his death and his resurrection. Verse 7 tells us what God is doing in us through our lives, which is killing our flesh so that we can be totally free from sin in glory. And always remember this past, present, and future tense. Okay, it's all true, all at the same time. Okay, it's almost like consider it done. Right, these things did happen. They're going to happen. Consider it done. Excuse me. Verses 9 and 10. We know that Christ, being raised from the dead, will never die again. Death no longer has dominion over him. For the death he died to sin once for all. But the life he lives to God. So in verses 9 and 10, Paul is telling us things about Christ that have meaning for us because we have true union with Christ. So he's saying things about Christ that he's going to apply to us because we are in Christ. Makes sense? We are in Christ. That's what the Bible speaks of. And that's why we are even called his body, the body of Christ, right? So first thing I want to ask here is, what does it mean that death had dominion over Christ? It's a question for all of you.
He was dead.
Okay.
He had dominion over us until he stepped in and took that for us.
Bingo. That's what I'm. That's really what I'm looking for. Okay. Yeah, because I don't want anyone to think when it says that Christ, that death had dominion over Christ, that that means that death was more powerful than Christ. That doesn't mean that, does it? He say that again.
He submitted to it.
Yes, he submitted himself to the dominion of death so that he could conquer death.
Because the wages of sin are death, and if he hadn't done that, then we could not be justified before God. Yes. This demands a blood sacrifice.
Amen. Right on. Right on. So, Paul goes on to say also that for the death he died to sin once for all. And then look at verse 11. So you must also consider yourselves dead to sin. So Christ died to sin once for all, and we are dead to sin. Consider yourselves dead to sin. So obviously, Christ being dead to sin and us dying to sin, there's a parallel as Paul draws, but it has to be different because Christ was perfect. He was sinless. We are not. We're not even close to that. So Christ, think of it this way. Christ died to put away sin. He died for sin. He died on behalf of sin. And we are dead to sin for the purpose of ceasing to commit sin. And so Christ died for sins on the cross, and then he was alive to God in the glory of God the Father, sitting at his right hand. Paul's drawing that parallel to us. And no, it's not perfect one-to-one, obviously. But he's drawing that parallel to us because of Christ, we have died to sin. And now we are no longer enemies of God. We are alive to God in the presence of God the Father with unveiled face, as Paul says in 2 Corinthians chapter 3. Okay, and again, verse 11 is very important because it's a summary. It's a summary of what's going on here. So you must also consider yourselves dead to sin and alive to God in Christ Jesus. We are no longer enemies. This is a major point that has come up in the past couple weeks when Rick was teaching. We were enemies, and now we are friends, sons of God, children of God. Excuse me. Can someone turn to Galatians 2:20? Just to stay on this point for a moment.
Blair could probably say it by you.
I am crucified with Christ by faith, and I no longer live, but he lives in me who died, who loved me and gave himself away. I'm sorry.
Almost. Well, we'll give it to you.
I'm crucified with Christ, nevertheless I live, yet not I, but Christ lives in me, the life which I now live in the flesh, I live by the faith of the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me.
What he said.
What a beautiful verse. What a beautiful verse. And I think that's a great verse to kind of summarize the first 11 verses. We died with Christ. We're crucified with him. Therefore, it's no longer us who live, but it's Christ who lives through us. So how could you possibly say that you're just going to live any old way you want? I thought it was Christ who's living in you. You were crucified with him. See?
Nick, there's one other thing that, if I might add, is that
Ephesians
1:19 and 20, where he says that you believe by the same power, in other words, the Holy Spirit power that raised Christ from the dead, dwells in us.
Right on.
So it is Christ in us. And
right on.
He indwells us with his power of his Holy Spirit to live a life that's pleasing to God.
Yeah. The same power that raised Christ from the dead raised us from the dead.
Yeah.
Amen. Alrighty, so the last section here, verses 12 through 14, I titled, Therefore, Act Like It. So because you have union with Christ, you, Christian, are united to Christ. I can't say that enough. Therefore, act like it. Let not sin, therefore, reign in your mortal body to make you obey its passions. Do not present your members to sin as instruments for unrighteousness, but present yourselves to God as those who have been brought from death to life. Excuse me, and your members to God as instruments for righteousness. For sin will have no dominion over you, since you are not under law, but under grace. So now after Paul gives us that lengthy discussion of sanctification in the Christian life, of what are the role, excuse me, what is the role of good works in the Christian life? That's kind of the real question that Paul has been answering here. Because we have union with Christ, we're to follow him. Now comes the exhortation. Because all of this is true, because we have union with Christ, don't sin. It's a pretty simple point here, pretty simple application. You have been freed from the bondage of sin, so don't sin. You're no longer enslaved to sin. What's John 8? What does Jesus say in John chapter 8? Right? He who practices sin is a slave to sin, but the Son can set you free. When you profess that you're a Christian, what you're saying is, I've been set free. My chains are gone, right? We all know the awesome, amazing hymn called Amazing Grace. So don't sin. So your body can be used as a tool for the devil, or your body can be used as a tool for Christ. So again, how can you who have been freed from sin use your body as a tool for wickedness? Doesn't make much sense, does it? And notice, verse 14, sin will have no dominion over you. You've been freed from the dominion of sin, but often when we present ourselves before the devil and walk in his ways, we put ourselves back under that dominion in some way. It's like we're asking the devil to chain us again. You can't do that because God's the one who freed you.
I'm thinking of a passage that says something like that, like you've been freed from sin, so you know don't go back into slavery under that. Mm-hmm. There's something.
You're talking about Galatians, where it says, why would you want to go back into the slavery of the law?
Wait a minute.
Yeah.
Bingo. Yeah. Why would you have been freed from the power of the law, kind of put yourself again under that yoke, I think. Okay, and then we get the very, very famous verse. Very, very famous verse. What is that? Well, since you are not under law, you are under grace. People say that all the time. You know, Nick, we're not under law. You know, I don't really need to go to church on Sunday. You know, meeting together. I neglect the meeting together, the assembling of yourselves. I know the Bible says not to, but I'm not under law. I'm under grace.
So you want to be miserable and wallow in the mud rather than embrace the joy that is in Christ.
Amen. And that's the primary problem. But there's even a more foundational problem with that. And it's that they didn't read the first 13 verses. I mean, they just didn't read it. Paul's whole point here is don't sin. They didn't even read the verse prior to it. They didn't even read 13. They probably didn't read the ones after. If you just read a little more, it's very, very clear. Paul's whole point is that we are free from sin, from its bondage. So don't sin, because we've been united to Christ. So what does it mean to not be under law? Well, first let's talk about what does it mean to be under law. It means to be under law means to be under the yoke of the law, seeking to obtain righteousness by the law, right? It's to be under its yoke. It's a burden. Because you can never fulfill the law. It's a giant burden on your back. You're never going to be able to fulfill. So what's the point that we're not under law but under grace? Sin will have no dominion. What's the point? Well, because you're not under that yoke, seeking to obtain righteousness by that, you can actually follow God. Why? Because you're under grace. You're under grace. I summarize it this way. Without the grace of God, the law is a yoke. Without the grace of God, the law is a yoke. But with the grace of God, the law is a law of liberty, as James says, in which our souls should take delight in, like David in Psalm 1. Right? So when we're seeking to obtain righteousness by the law, we're under its yoke, it's weighing us down, we can never fulfill it. However, when we are freed from that bondage to the law and to sin, free to follow God, the law is a law of liberty in which we take delight in. Does that make sense? All right. Any questions or comments on that? Do we get what that verse is saying?
Well, one of the things I think we, as Americans, the idea of liberty being, and it's really a modern idea, is that means that you have no restraints and there's nothing that you can't do. Absolutely, you know, I know I can't run a triathlon. It's not going to happen. It would take me years to get ready to do that. So there's lots of things that you can't do. And we just were so individualistic and we're so want to concentrate, well, then I should be free to do anything. No, you're not, because you, for one thing, we need to protect you from stuff that won't make you happy and will kill you.
Right. Right on. Yeah, the confession talks about, it has a section on, I'm blanking on the title of the section, Christian liberty. Christian liberty. And it talks about how Christian liberty isn't licensed to sin. Like most people use this verse for. They use this verse to say, well, I'm not under law, I'm under grace, so I can sin all I want. But real Christian liberty is actually to be liberated to not sin. To have liberty to follow Christ, right? We've been freed from those chains, and we have a new heart. We can actually follow God. We can't follow Him perfectly in this life because we still have that flesh that we are slowly trying to get rid of. But we are not under the power of sin and death. We're all going to die. But we are not under the power of sin, so we can follow God more and more through our life. Alrighty, any last comments or anything before we move on to some application questions that I have on your sheet there? Alrighty. What are some practical things that happen to us when we forget that we were united to Christ? What are some practical things that happen to us or can happen to us when we forget that we were united to Christ?
Seems like one of the obvious ones would be slip back into sin.
Right.
When we lose hope as I strive to attain a righteousness through the law and get frustrated and say, well, I just can't do this. These Christians are too tough because I've lost sight of this.
We think of Christ. Yeah, right on. We think of Christ's death and just He paid the fine. If we're not united to Him, He died and our fine has been paid, but we forget about the life that we have in Him because we were raised with Him.
Right. God's grace doesn't stop at justification. Sorry.
We put the burden on ourselves.
Mm-hmm. We leave all kinds of bad stuff.
Right. Right. It's that kind of touches on a word that we've talked about before, antinomianism, which is anti-law. Yeah. Those are people who profess to be Christians yet think that they can live like the devil. And just because they claim to believe in Jesus, that means that their ticket is punched and they can, they're saved. Yeah.
People believe that, have a tendency to believe that salvation is an event, not a way of life.
Right. That's good. Mm-hmm. That's good. Yeah.
That's funny, because that's what I explained to one of my coworkers when he was telling me, I believe in God, but I don't believe I have to attend church. So I had to explain the difference between being spiritual and what salvation is.
Yeah, right.
A big difference.
Yeah, right. Yeah, you can be kind of quasi-spiritual and do your meditation and yet not be right with God. So.
You and I know a guy who just really didn't, for a long time, he gets it now, but didn't understand this union with Christ and the impact, and really strove with the fact that he didn't see how his sanctification was progressing. He thought he had to put all the effort into it, and didn't appreciate the fact that he was united to Christ and what that signified. He lost a lot of hope and was very scared.
Yeah.
Because, he would sin.
Right.
And he was very scared of that. So, I think there's a lot going on there if we forget our union with Christ.
That's right. Yeah, because there's such a great balance here that we have to have. If we only think that God's grace is justification, salvation is justification, that's it, then you're probably going to be anti-law and not seek to live a life of holiness. Yet if you only think Salvation is sanctification. You kind of start to forget justification, that you have been justified by faith, and that faith is a gift in Christ, then you might start to walk towards legalism. That's kind of what you're getting at, I think.
It's interesting how we connect the dots to this and Romans 8:15, where it says, "We will not receive the spirit of bondage again to fear, but the spirit of adoption, whereby we cry, Abba, Father." So we're not the spirit of bondage to drive us to do this, but we receive the spirit of adoption. We've been brought into the family of God through Jesus Christ. And the work of the Holy Spirit is, according to Galatians 5:22, is bring us the fruit of the Spirit, which is love and joy and peace and long-suffering.
Right.
Joy. Joy. Faith and meekness and temperance. Against such there is no
more. Amen. Amen. And that touches on something I said a little earlier about the law being a law of liberty for the Christian. It's guidance. Yeah. All right, number two, what are some practical things that we can do daily to enable us to present ourselves to God as instruments of righteousness? This is something Paul commands us to do. Present yourselves to God as instruments for righteousness. It's a command. Do this. What are some practical things that we can do daily to really work on that? To really do that? Because it takes work.
Pray.
Pray. Bingo. Bingo. Two bingos.
What is this? Bingo night?
Pray and read your Bible.
Assemble with God's people.
Communion with God. In time with God during the day. Say that again, Pastor Bob.
Assemble with God's people and worship.
Yes.
Romans 12 says, "Be transformed by the renewing of your mind."
Whoa, Blair, that's good.
Bingo. Bingo. Right on.
That'll preach.
That'll preach. All right, last question so we can get to it here. If someone works harder to earn money than they do in serving God, then what needs to change in their thinking?
They need to start idolizing money.
That's definitely a big point. Yes.
Idolatry.
But not the hard work. That's a heart thing rather than what you are doing.
Yeah, it's what are you focused on?
Right, because this says that it's you to earn money is the glorious thing. So whatever you can do, lie, cheat, steal, kill, whatever, to earn that money. Yeah. Versus you can do the same thing, earn the money, but still a bit of glory.
Right on.
For the glory of God here. Same action, earning the money, two different reasons.
Yeah, Proverbs talks all about this. You fear the Lord, that's the beginning of wisdom. And with wisdom, generally speaking, will breed success in certain areas of our lives.
The question makes me think of Ecclesiastes. And don't focus on all these temporary things that are just going to end. And also store up your treasure in heaven. Focus on the things of the Lord, those things will last.
Right.
Bingo.
Bunch of bingo winners today.
People that are watching this tape and think, what are those Presbyterians doing? It's bingo night.
Well, one last thing to go ahead, Blair.
Please ask what I love about guys like True or Kathy. Like Chick-fil-A, founder of
Chick-fil-A. Oh, yeah.
Tremendously successful.
Right.
So,
all to the glory of God. Yeah. So with your glory. One last thing about this question is salvation. God has saved you. God the Father sent His Son into the world to die for you. Christ emptied Himself to the point of death. And you're working harder for your comfort than to commune with God, to serve God who rescued you from hell. Something off there in our priorities.
If I earn more money, though, I can tithe more.
Oh, great argument.
So God will love you more, right?
Exactly. Yeah. Exactly. Well, let me into heaven if I tithe.
Yes. And with that, we will close. let's pray. Father in heaven, we thank you, Lord, that your great grace that you've bestowed on us doesn't stop at justification, but that you also shed off our old man. And one day we will stand before you and be like your Son, Jesus Christ, because we will see him face to face. And we thank you for that glorious hope we have because of your great gospel. We ask you, Father, to fix our eyes on you as we go into worship. And I pray that your spirit would be with us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.